This question was asked in GATE 2007. The question is, in a P plus N junction diode under reverse bias, the magnitude of electric field is maximum at, option A is the edge of the depletion region on the P side, option B is the edge of the depletion region on the N side, C is the P plus N junction, and D is the center of the depletion region on the N side. So this is the question in which we have a P plus N junction. So we have marked this one. This is a P plus N junction. And in this P plus N junction, we have to find out the magnitude of the electric field where it is existing maximum. So here we have four condition. According to the four condition, we have to find out the maximum value of electric field where it is existing. For getting out the solution of this question, we have drawn a P plus N junction. So first we need to know what is a P plus N junction diode. A P plus N junction means P side is heavily doped. A P plus N junction, that means P side is it is heavily doped. And the N side, that is it is P plus and N side, and it is lightly doped. So when we doped this semiconductor, we are doping the P side with donor acceptor atoms, which is denoted by Na, and the N side is doped with donor atoms. And in donor atoms, we consist of a positive ion with one electron. So we consist this, the whole N side consists of a positive ion with one electrons like this. So this is the N side. So here we have the acceptor atoms, and here we have the donor atoms. So if you see both the sides, this side is heavily doped. That means the number of acceptor atoms is very much greater than the number of donor atoms. This is the condition. So the number of acceptor atoms is very much greater than donor atoms. And according to our previous studies, we know that whenever a diode is heavily doped, the depletion region always penetrate into the lightly doped side. So here, since the donor atom is lightly doped side, the depletion region will penetrate more towards the lightly doped side. So here we can see the depletion region, and in this depletion region, it consists of the ions, because the depletion region will form when the charge carrier, that is electrons or holes, are removed. That is, it will recombine, and after recombination, we are getting the depletion region. And in this depletion region, we are having only the ions. And in these ions, we can see the N side is the depth of depletion region towards N side is more, and the depth of depletion region towards P side is less. So we have another condition similar to this one. The depth of depletion region towards P side, that is the width of depletion region towards P side, is less than the width of depletion region towards N side. These two are the condition, and according to this condition, we have to find out where the electric field is maximum. So here we have four options according to this question. The first option is the edge of the depletion region on P side. That means this is the P side, and this is this particular line is the edge of the depletion region towards P side. And this is the point where we have to find out the electric field, whether it is existing maximum or not. And this is the A option. And the second option is B, the edge of the depletion region towards N side. That means this is the edge of the depletion region towards N side, and this is this is the point where the electric field is existing maximum. This is the point. And if you see the C option, according to C option, the P plus N junction, that means this is the point. Suppose we have, this is the junctions of this P plus N, and this is the point, or maybe we are getting the maximum electric field at this point. And the last is, we can see the center of the depletion region on N side. And we can see this is the depletion region, and this is the depletion region towards N side. and we can say this is D option, the center of the depletion region towards N side, we may get the maximum electric field at this point. So for getting this one, where the maximum electric field is existing, we have to find out the charge density and the electric field both. Since we know that from Poisson's equation, we know that d square v divided by dx square is equal to minus rho v divided by epsilon. Here, this rho v is nothing but the charge density. So, for getting the solution of this equation, we will first find out what is the charge density. Then we are going to use another equation, and by using the second equation, we will find out the electric field, maximum electric field where it is existing. So this is the first equation, and second equation is, we know that the electric field is equal to minus dV by dx. So by using these two equation, we are going to find out where the maximum electric field is existing. So first of all, we should know what is the charge density, since we know that from the neutrality of a semiconductor, we know that whether we are having a n-type or p-type semiconductor or an intrinsic semiconductor, every semiconductor is electrically neutral. So if you see on p side, this side is electrically neutral, and if you see the n side, this side is also electrically neutral. So either we can say like this, or we are having this, since this is negative ion and this is holes, the holes is having positive charge and this ion is having negative charge. So if you take together, the number of ions on P side is equal to number of the positive charge, that is holes existing on P side. So if this is negative, this is positive, combinedly we can see this is neutral. So that means here we have neutral. The charge density, there is no charge density, and we are getting the neutral charge. There is no charge and it is neutral. And on the right side, that is on N side, we can see the same thing, that electrons is having the negative charge and this ion is having the positive charge. So the reason is similar, and here also we have the neutral, that is we are getting the neutral charges. So both the sides are electrically neutral, and the charges, if you find out the charge density, the charges that we can see in this P plus N junction diode is nothing but on the depletion region, and in the depletion region we have the negative ions on this side and the positive ions on this side. So for getting this one, if you draw the similar way, suppose this is the diode and this is the depletion region. And if you see, this is the point where the junction of the depletion region is existing. This is P side and this is N side. And if you draw the characteristic of charge density, that is rho v, with respect to the distance x, since this is the distance x. So here we have the ions, and this ions is nothing but the negative ions. And here we have the ions, and this ions is nothing but the positive ion. This is the point where here this is P side, this is N side. So if you use the neutrality, then we are not having any charge density on this P side up to this point. So this is the edge of the depletion region. Up to this point, we don't have any charges. So the rho v value, that is the charge density, number of charge per centimeter cube, is equal to zero up to this point, that is the edge of the depletion region on P side. And similarly on this side also, we are having, this is neutral, this is the area where we don't have any charges, that is the charge has been neutralized. So here we are having, that is there is zero, the charge density will be equal to zero. So if you see on this side, that is where the depletion region is actually existing, and where we have the ions, if you see on this side, the charges which is existing on P site is nothing but the negative charges. And if it is negative charges, and if every acceptor atoms will donate one electron to its semiconductor, that is every acceptor atoms, that means Na is ionized, then the maximum number of ions that we can see in this depletion region is equal to Na, and it is negative. So we can see the, we can, if you draw this one on negative side, this is the charge density, and since these charges are negatives, that's why we have drawn on the negative portion of this graph. And the utmost we are getting, the number of ions is equal to Na. So Na is the number of ions, that is the maximum value of ions that we can get if every acceptor atoms has been ionized. So this is the junction point, and if every donor atoms on the N side has been ionized, then we are getting the maximum number of ions, that is positive ions, on this depletion region is nothing but the Nd. So we are getting here Nd. So since this is the number of acceptor and donor ions, if you multiply this one with the value of Q, we are getting the charge density. So if you multiply that with Q, we are getting the charge density. So this is the graph which has been plotted, the distribution of this charge density distribution in a P plus N junction, and the diagram is like this. So if you see the diagram, that is the graph that has been plotted between charge density and X, then we can see this is the portion where the junction is existing, and on the right side of this junction where the donor atoms are existing, or we are saying that where the N side is existing, the negative side is suddenly changes with positive. So this type of junction is also known as, if you see on left side, we are getting the maximum negative here, we are having the maximum negative portion, and on just right side, that is here, we are having the maximum positive. Maximum positive. So this is maximum negative portion and this is maximum positive portion at the same point. On the same point we are getting at the junction. So this type of change of charges at a same point is known as, this junction is known as abrupt junction. Abrupt junction. And this type of semiconductor is known as step graded semiconductor. This type of semiconductor is also known as step-graded semiconductor. So this is the point. Now if you got this charge density value, we can now draw the electric field. And if you integrate, see here, if you integrate d square b by dx square, then if we know that electric field is equal to minus dv by dx. And if you integrate this d square b by dx square, then we are getting the integration of this one, and the integration of this one is equal to minus, is equal to rho v divided by epsilon, and epsilon is constant, which is permittivity, and this is the charge density. We are getting the integration of charge density. So if you further use this equation, the electric field can be seen, it is directly proportional to the integration of the charge density. So that means if you integrate this charge density function with respect to x, then we can get the electric field. So it is with respect to x, so we are having the dx value here. Since the permittivity is constant, so if electric field is integrated, if the charge density is integrated, then we can get the electric field. So electric field is directly proportional to charge density, and this is with respect to x. So in this question also, he has asked that what is the maximum value of electric field. So for getting this maximum value of electric field, we must integrate the graph which has been plotted with respect to this charge density. And we know that this particular graph is nothing but a step function. So we can see this is a step function, and if you integrate a step function, since we know that integration is nothing but the summation of a continuous value, and if you integrate this step function, and we know that integration of step function always gives a ramp that is which is linearly increasing. So up to this point, again, if you see up to this point, the electric field is nothing but the integration of this charge density. And since up to this point, the charge density value is equal to zero, so the electric field is also equal to zero. So the electric field at every point on this P side is equal to zero. And similarly, if you see on the other side, the electric field is equal to zero because the charge density, that is rho v, is equal to zero. So we can write here, this is rho v is equal to zero. Here the charge density rho v is equal to zero. So, and both the side, the electric field E is also equal to zero. Here also, the electric field E is also equal to zero. But at this point, at the edge of the depletion region on P side, we can see this is a step function, and the integration of step function, that is integration of rho v, will give the electric field. So also it is a continuous summation. So we can use directly draw a ramp function, and this is, since this is negative, so we are getting a negative slope. So this is having a negative slope. Since this step function is having negative slope, so we are getting negative slope up to the junction of this particular depletion region. And after this, we are having the positive step function. And because of this positive step function, we are again having the integration, and this integration will give the electric field. And this integration of just charge density, and it is having positive charge density. So the integration of this positive charge density is giving a slope, and this slope is nothing but the positive slope. So we are having the negative slope on P side, and we are having the positive slope on N side. But at this particular line, that means at the junction, we are having the electric field. So this is nothing but the diagram of electric field. This is the graph of the charge density, and this is nothing but the PN junction. So here, the electric field, we can see the electric field is maximum at the junction. So we can use this particular thing for this question. So the electric field, if you see the four options, the edge of the depletion region on P side, if you see the edge of the depletion region on P side, we can see the electric field is equal to zero. In this diagram, we can see the electric field is equal to zero. And similarly, if you see on this side, the electric field is equal to zero. And this is the second option, B. The electric field is equal to zero at the edge of the depletion region on N side. And this is second option. So both these options are correct wrong, because if you see the four options, the first option is the edge of the depletion region on P side. And this is the point where the edge of the depletion region on P side is existing. And if you see the diagram of electric field at the edge of the depletion region on P side, the electric field is equal to zero. So we can write here, the electric field is equal to zero at the edge of the depletion region on P side. Similarly, if you see the B option, in B option, this is the edge of the depletion region on N side, and the electric field here also equal to zero. By this diagram, we can see this is the point where the edge of the depletion region on N side is existing, and the electric field is equal to zero. So this B option is wrong, and this A option is wrong, because at both this option, the electric field is equal to zero. And if you see the third option, at P plus N junction, that means this is the C option, and this is the point where the junction is existing. And if you see from this diagram of electric field, the electric field is maximum. We can see this is the point. So we are writing here, this is the E maximum point. So by taking one arrow, I have taken written this one. This is the point where electric field is maximum. So we can write here, this is the point where the P plus N junction. This is the point where electric field is maximum. And this is the correct answer. And at last we can see the center of the depletion region on N side. So this is the point D point. This is the point where the center of the depletion region on N side is existing. And this is somewhere here that is existing on the graph plotted between electric field and X. And this is the point, but here the electric field is not maximum. So I can say the fourth option, this is electric field, is this is not maximum. That means here the electric field is not maximum. So these are the four options, and if you see, the C option is correct among these four. This question was asked in GATE 2012. The question is, the IV characteristic of the diode in the circuit given below are, I is equal to V minus 0.7 by 500 ampere when V is greater than equal to 0.7 volt. And this is equal to 0 ampere when V is less than 0.7 volt. The current in the circuit is A 10 milliampere, B 9.3 milliampere, C 6.67 milliampere, D 6.2 milliampere. So this is the question where one equation is given, the relationship between I and V, the current and voltage. This current and voltage is the current that is flowing through the diode, and this voltage is the voltage across the diode. So there is one relationship which shows that when current is flowing, when voltage is greater than equal to 0.7 volt, and otherwise it will be equal to 0. That means in all other voltage, the current is equal to 0. So this is the circuit which is given in the question. And in this circuit, we have three components, that is 10 volt battery, 1 kilo ohm resistor, and one diode. And this is the current which is flowing through the diode. So in this circuit, the diode, this diode is nothing but the symbol of the diode. So whenever we are solving the equation which consists of the diode, there are three models by which the diode can be replaced by its equivalent circuit. So the model that we have to use here, suppose we are using, there are three models. The first model is, if you can say, this is ideal model, or we can say this is ideal diode model. So in this ideal diode model, or in any other model, there are two parameters which have to use here. The parameters of the diode are is nothing but the resistance, the forward resistance of the diode, and the forward, the cut-in voltage of the diode. These are the two parameters, the forward resistance and the cut-in voltage. So always we are considering the diode, this model, in forward bias, because in reverse bias, this model is in this model, in reverse bias condition, the diode is acting as an open circuited. So we have two things that we have to use here, that is the forward bias mode and in the reverse bias mode. In forward bias mode, all the model is working in open circuited. That means in this model, the resistance, the reverse resistance is infinite. So we can write in this form, this the reverse resistance R is equal to infinite. That is, the diode is acting as open circuited whenever we are studying in reverse bias mode. But in forward bias mode, in ideal model, the these two parameters, the forward resistance is equal to 0 and the cut-in voltage V gamma is equal to 0. Here, the cut-in voltage is the voltage above which the diode starts conducting. This is the definition of the cut-in voltage. It is the voltage above which the current starts flowing through the diode. That means below this voltage, the current is negligibly small. And if you see the second model by which the diode can be replaced, and this model is nothing but the simplified model. So in this model, again, we are having both forward and reverse bias condition. And of course, we know that in reverse bias condition, here also, it is acting as an open circuited. So in forward bias mode, the reverse forward resistance is equal, not here it is equal to zero, and the cut-in voltage V gamma is not equal to zero. This is the second, first condition when we are talking about simplified model and we are taking forward bias. And when we are working in reverse bias mode, this is acting as open circuited, that means the reverse resistance is equal to infinite. That means the infinite resistance means it is open circuited. And the third model by which the diode can be replaced is nothing but the piecewise linear model. And in this piecewise linear model, we are again considering both the condition, that is forward and reverse bias mode. And in forward bias mode, the forward resistance is not equal to zero here, and the cut-in voltage is also not equal to zero. But in reverse bias condition, we can say the reverse resistance is equal to infinity. That means it is open, acting as an open circuit. So we can see in all the models that we are going to use for replacing the diode, in reverse bias mode the circuit is acting as an open circuited, and in forward bias mode we have two parameters that has to be considered. Now if you compare these three model with the given equation of the diode, we can see easily see that in when the current is flowing through the diode, that is when I is not equal to zero, the equation is I is equal to V minus 0.7 divided by 500. That means this current is flowing when voltage is greater than 0.7 volt. What does it mean? It means that voltage, when voltage is less than zero, less than 0.7 volt, then the current value is equal to zero. That means there is no current up to this particular voltage. That means this particular voltage gives the value of the cut-in voltage for this particular diode. So this voltage is represented by V gamma, and V gamma is equal to 0.7 volt. So this is the condition. That means we can use both this model. In simplified model we have V gamma not equal to zero, and in piecewise linear model also we have V gamma is not equal to zero. We can use both this model. But if you consider this equation, by this equation we can see this is nothing but the equation of a line. So if you compare this equation, that is I is equal to V minus 0.7 divided by 500 with equation of line, line equation is equal to Y is equal to MX plus C. So if you consider this equation, compare this equation with this equation, then we can see this I is equal to Y and this V is equal to X. So if you draw the characteristic is drawn between the X and Y coordinate. Here this is the X coordinate and we are using the voltage V here, and this is the Y coordinate and we are using the current characteristic of the diode here. So if you see, draw the piecewise linear model. In this piecewise linear model, V gamma is not equal to zero. Here also we have V gamma is equal to 0.7 volt. And if you compare this equation, this is a line equation which increases linearly. So that means we have to use the piecewise linear model here. So if you draw the piecewise linear model according to these parameters of the diode, then the characteristic can be seen like this. This red mark, we can see the characteristic is like this. That means up to this point there is no current, that is current is equal to zero. And if you increase the voltage above this 0.7 volt, the current increasing linearly, and we are having, since we are having this particular value which is nothing but the slope of this one, and because of this slope we are getting M here. So this is the characteristic. So we have got one parameters of the diode, that is nothing but V gamma which is equal to 0.7 volt. The other parameter of the diode is nothing but RF, which is known as the forward resistance of the diode, and this forward resistance is also known as the dynamic resistance. And for getting the dynamic resistance, we must differentiate the voltage with respect to the current. So this is the small change in voltage with respect to a small change in current. So by this equation we can find out this value. If you differentiate this equation, That means we can get the value of 1 upon RF, and this 1 upon RF is nothing but if you differentiate this one, that is dV divided by dI divided by dV. That means the small change in current divided by small change in voltage, then we must got the value that is equal to 1 divided by 500. And this 1 divided by 500 is nothing but the resistance 1 upon RF. And if you want to find out the value of RF, the RF is equal to 500. So this is 500 ohm. So we can write the RF resistance that is equal to 0.5 kilo ohm. So this is the second parameter, and this one is the first parameter. So by using these two parameters, we can use this piecewise linear model characteristic and replace the symbol of the diode by its equivalent circuit. So in this equivalent circuit, we know we have the same thing, that is the 10 volt battery which is plus here and minus here, and we have one resistance, and this resistance is equal to 1 kilo ohm. And from these two terminal, we can see from this symbol, this is the positive polarity, this is the P terminal of the diode, this is the N terminal of the diode. So according to this one, we can replace the diode by its equivalent model. So in this equivalent model, we can see we have two parameters. One is V gamma, that is cut-in voltage, one is the forward resistance. So we can draw this one. This is the forward resistance RF, which is equal to 0.5 kilo ohm. And this is the cut-in voltage V gamma, which is equal to 0.7 volt. So here we have the current which is flowing through the diode. So the potential between the diode can be seen, the potential between these two terminals. So here the diode is replaced by its equivalent model, which consists of RF and V gamma. So if we apply the KVL here, by applying the KVL, we can find out here, we can see, we can have to find out the current that is flowing through the circuit. So for getting the current that is flowing through the circuit, we can apply the KVL. So by applying KVL in the given circuit, we can find out the value of I. So we can write this I is equal to this 10 minus this 0.7 volt divided by the addition of these two resistor, that is 1.5 kilo ohm. So this is equal to 10 minus 0.7, that means this is equal to 9.3 divided by 1.5 kilo ohm, that is equal to 6.3 milliampere. And this 6.3 milliampere is the correct answer, and this is the current which is flowing through the diode. And from these options, we can see this is equal to 6.2 milliampere. So in this circuit, the current through the diode that has been asked, so here you have to find out the current I. So for getting this current I, which is question mark here, we have to apply KVL. So by applying KVL in the given circuit, so apply KVL in the loop. So by applying KVL, we can find out the value of I. So this I is equal to the potential that has been applied externally, which is equal to V. And here this V is nothing but equal to 10 volt minus the cut-in voltage that is equal to 0.7 divided by the resistance, the total resistance across this loop. And this is equal to 1 kilo ohm plus 0.5 kilo ohm. That means this is equal to 1.5 kilo ohm. So after solving this, this is 10 minus 0.7. That is equal to 9.3 divided by 1.5 K. And this is equal to, the answer is 6.2 milliampere. And this is the value of current that is flowing through the circuit. And this I is equal to 6.2 milliampere. So if you see the options in the question, option D, here the option D is showing 6.2 milliampere, and this is the correct answer for this question. This is the question from GATE 2015. and the question is from set 1. The question is, the built-in potential of an abrupt p-n junction is 0.75 volt if its junction capacitance Cj at reverse bias Vr of 1.25 volt is 5 picofarad. The value of Cj in picofarad when Vr is equal to 7.25 volt is. So this is the question, and in this question we have the given condition is that the built-in potential of p-n junction is given, which is equal to 0.75, and it is given that the semiconductor is reverse bias, and we have junction capacitance which is equal to 5 picofarad at Vr1 is equal to 1.25 volt. We have to find out the junction capacitance in picofarad when Vr is equal to 7.25. This is the question. So in this question we have to find out the value of this Cj2. So now consider this question, and in this question this statement is given. In this statement, this is abrupt p-n junction. The meaning of this abrupt is same as this is a step graded p-n junction, step graded p-n junction. And in this step graded p-n junction, we have to find out the capacitance when it is in reverse bias. So when the p-n junction is in reverse bias condition, at that time there is a capacitance which is developed at the junction, and this capacitance is same as the capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor. So since we know the capacitance of a parallel plate capacitor C is equal to epsilon, the permittivity into area of cross section divided by the distance between the parallel plates. And in this question, this is the capacitance which is developed at the junction, and at the junction we have depletion region, and this D represents the width of the depletion region. So we can write this is nothing but epsilon A divided by the width of the depletion region, and this is the junction capacitance which has been developed. So from this equation we can see that junction capacitance is inversely proportional to width of the depletion region. And if you find out the relationship between the width of the depletion region and the reverse voltage, we have to take one equation, and that equation is width of the depletion region is equal to, this is 2 epsilon, the barrier potential divided by Q, and this is multiplied by 1 upon ND plus 1 upon NA. And the whole thing is powered by N. This is the equation. From this equation, if ND and NA, that is constant, and if you take a particular semiconductor, like suppose we are taking ND, that is N-type semiconductor, then this NA is neglected. So likewise we can take, so it is a p-n junction, so we can directly take that this all things remains constant, then we can write the width of the junction, that is the depletion region, is directly proportional to the barrier potential, and this will be raised to N. This is the equation. So from here we come to know that the width of the junction is directly proportional to barrier potential. So now we have to find out what is actually N. N is a constant, and it is 1 by 2 if you are considering a step graded semiconductor, and same N is equal to 1 upon 3 if you are consider a linearly graded semiconductor. So from this equation we come to know that W is directly proportional to VB raised to 1 by 2, since our question is for step graded semiconductor. since it is given, the question is for abrupt semiconductor, and that is nothing but an step graded semiconductor. And the junction capacitance is directly proportional to 1 upon W, inversely proportional, and this is directly proportional to the VB raised to 1 upon 2. And we can write this is equal to 1 upon VB, and this is under root. So this VB is the varier potential, and for reverse biasing, the varier potential is equal to the built-in potential plus the reverse bias applied. What is this contact potential or built-in potential? This built-in potential is the potential when the semiconductor diode is under open circuited condition. And when a reverse bias is applied, the effective barrier potential has been increased. And the effective barrier potential is equal to the open circuited potential, that is the built-in potential, plus the potential which is externally applied, that is the reverse biasing potential. So the effective barrier potential will be the addition of built-in potential plus reverse bias voltage. So we can write here, this is equal to 1 upon root over the built-in potential, here it is given as VBI, plus the reverse bias voltage. So now we have two junction capacitance. In this question, we have two junction capacitance, that is CJ1 and CJ2. So CJ2, we have to find out this value CJ2. So from this equation, we come to know that the CJ is inversely proportional to the root over of the built-in potential VBI plus the reverse potential. Or we can write this is equal to VBI plus the reverse potential raised to minus 1 by 2. So we can find out this value by taking the ratio of these two. So this can be find out CJ2 divided by the CJ1, and this is equal to root over the built-in potential VB1 plus the externally applied reverse bias voltage of first condition, and this is inversely proportional, that's why in the denominator this is VBI plus VR2, and this VBI is a constant which is given in the question, that is equal to 0.75, here it is given. So I am taking this one, this is equal to 0.75 plus the reverse bias potential of first condition, and that is equal to 1.25 volt. And similarly for the second one, we can take this is equal to 0.75 plus the reverse bias voltage of in second condition, that is equal to 7.25 volt, which is given. So we can find out by using this equation, CJ2 is equal to, or we can take the ratio, this is equal to 0.7 plus 5 plus 1.25, that is equal to root over 2. And this is equal to root over 0.7 plus 5 plus 7.25, that is equal to root over 8. And this is equal to root over 2, and root over 8 can be written as twice of root over 2, and this will be cancelled, and we are getting 1 by 2. That means CJ2 is equal to half of CJ1. And in the question, the value of CJ1 is given, and this is equal to 5 picofarad. That means we can apply here 5 picofarad. So the resultant value of CJ2 is equal to 5 divided by 2, that is 2.5 picofarad. And this will be the correct answer for this question. This question was asked in GATE 2016 set 1. The question is, consider a silicon PN junction with a uniform acceptor doping concentration of
10^17 per centimeter cube on the P side and a uniform donor doping concentration of 10^16 centimeter cube per centimeter cube on the N side. No external voltage is applied to the diode given KT upon Q is equal to 26 millivolt. Intrinsic concentration Ni is equal to 1.5 × 10^10 per centimeter cube. Permittivity of silicon is equal to 12 epsilon naught, where epsilon naught is equal to 8.85 × 10^-14 farad per centimeter, and Q is equal to 1.6 × 10^-19 coulomb. The charge per unit junction area within bracket nanocoulomb per centimeter square in the depletion region on the P side is.
So according to the question, here is the given condition. We have a silicon PN junction which is having the acceptor concentration of 10^17 per centimeter cube and donor concentration of 10^16 per centimeter cube. So from here we can see that the acceptor atoms are greater than the donor atoms. Here we can having that conclusion, and other things also are so given, that is KT upon Q, which is nothing but VT, that is thermal voltage, which is, as we know, at room temperature its value is 26 millivolt. Ni, the intrinsic concentration, that is the number of electrons or holes present when the semiconductor is under intrinsic, it is 1.5 × 10^10 per centimeter cube. The permittivity of silicon is equal to 12 × εo, where εo is the permittivity of free space and which is having the value 8.85 × 10^-14 farad per centimeter. And Q is also given, which is equal to 1.6 × 10^-19 coulomb. So here in this question, we have to find out the charge per unit area. And this is the formula for charge per unit area. And we have to find out the charge per unit area in the depletion region on P side. It is given in the question. So the depletion region on P side, that means the width of the depletion region on P side, where we have to find out the concentration of charges per unit area. And the unit is also given, that is we have to find in nanocoulomb per centimeter square. This is already given. So from the question, we can see that this is the diode which is consisting of P and N. That means it is having a junction. And on one side, we have doped the semiconductor with acceptor atoms, and on the other side, we have doped the semiconductor with donor atoms. So I am marking here, we have doped the semiconductor with acceptor atoms on P side, and we have doped the semiconductor with donor atoms on N side. So in this question, it is already given that we have not applied any electric field. So since we have not applied any electric field, the movement of charge carrier due to drift is equal to zero. That means there is no movement of electrons or holes. Here we can see this is nothing but the electrons. This particular thing is nothing but the electrons, which is a movable charge carrier and which carries the current. And here we can see this is the holes. These are the holes, which is also current carrying charge carriers. So both are, these are on P side and N side. This is on P side and this is on N side. So since we are not applied any electric field, that means there is no current because of electric field. So the charge which is moving from P side to N side or N side to P side is because of change in concentration gradient. Since we have doped this side with the N-type particle and we have doped with the P-type on the other side, that means because of change in concentration on both sides, that is the majority charge carrier here is electrons and here the majority charge carrier is holes. And because of the difference in concentration, the charge particle starts moving. When the charge particle starts moving, because of recombination, a depletion layer is formed. In between this N side and P side, because of recombination of charge carrier, where this hole is moving on this side and electron is moving on this side, because of concentration gradient, the recombination occurs. And because of this recombination, a depletion layer is formed. And we can see this center area where we have, this is the width of the depletion region. And this center area is depleted of the current carrying charge carrier, that is electrons and holes. So this region is known as depletion region. So depletion region, this particular region is known as depletion region. That means this width is the width of the depletion region. And as we see from this diagram that here, this is actually a positive ion with an electron. This particular thing is nothing but a donor atoms. So when we remove the electrons from the donor atoms, the things that is left behind is nothing but the ion. So after recombination at the center of the p-n junction, the ions are left behind. And this ion is having positive charges on n side and negative charges on p side. So here this is positive charges and here these are the negative charges. And these are the ions, and ions are immobile, that we have to take under consideration, that ions are immobile. And because of this accumulation of ions, opposite ions on both sides of the depletion region, a electric field, or we can say a built-in potential, has been developed, and that built-in potential is denoted by V naught. This is the notation that has been used for the built-in potential. So at the depletion layer, because of the charges, accumulation of ions or charges on both sides, a potential difference has been created between N or P side, and that potential difference is calling it as a built-in potential, and this built-in potential is represented by V naught. So as we know from this question that we have to find out the charges per unit area. So if you write the formula to find out the charges, since charge are always available in a quantum, so according to quantization of charges, we know that if you are having charges, then it is always available in quantum. So this is Q into Na. So where Na is the number of acceptor atoms doped, and we have to find out the accumulation of charge on depletion region on P side. So depletion region on P side, that means on P side we have doped the semiconductor with acceptor atoms, and this acceptor atoms consist of electrons, holes and the ions, and after the hole accepts one electron, the charge that is left behind is nothing but the acceptor ion, that is the negative ions. So we have taken the multiplication of both. And we know that the width of the depletion region, from this diagram we can see the width of the depletion region consisting of the width of the depletion region on P side and the width of the depletion region on N side. That is, the total width is nothing but the width of the depletion region on P side and the width of the depletion region in N side, where WP is called the penetration of depletion region on P side, and WN is called the penetration of depletion region on N side. Since the concentration of acceptor atoms is greater than the concentration of donor atoms, so as we know from our previous discussion that the depletion region penetrate more into lightly doped side. So here the lightly doped side is, since the acceptor atoms concentration is greater than the donor atoms, so that means this side, that is N side, is lightly doped. This is lightly doped, relatively in comparison with this. And this is having the more doping in comparison with the other side, that is N side. It means that from the statement that depletion region penetrates more into lightly doped side, that means this side the penetration of depletion region is more, that means WN is more than WP. So from here this diagram also shows that, is diagram se bhi ye dikh raha hai, ki the width of the depletion region on P side is less and the width of the depletion region on N side is more, and the total combination of addition of width of the depletion region on P side and width of the depletion region on N side gives the width, total width of the depletion region. So this is the formula. So since in this question, the question is about the charges on the depletion region on p-side, so we are taking only the width of the depletion region on p-side. And to find out the charges, we have to take the width of the depletion region into cross-sectional area. This will give the volume of the semiconductors. This will give the volume and this volume. So total charges is equal to Q into Na into W into A. So if you find out the charge per unit area, that is Q divided by A, then we have to take the multiplication of Q into Na into WP. Then we can get the value for charge per unit area that was asked in this question. So from here we can find out the things that is not given in the question. So Q already it is given, that is this is equal to 1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19, which is given. Acceptor atom concentration is given, that is equal to 10 to the power 17 per centimeter cube. But we don't know the value of WP. So for to find out the value of WP, we have to use certain equation that is already used in previous questions. So that equation is, suppose we have to find out first this value, that is what is the built-in potential that is given by V naught. V naught is equal to KT ln into ND into NA divided by Ni square. This is nothing but the built-in potential, and the formula for built-in potential is KT ln ND into Na divided by Ni square, where K is the Boltzmann constant and T is the temperature, ND is the donor atom concentration and Na is the acceptor atom concentration, and Ni square is the intrinsic concentration. So for getting this one, we have to put the formula in this form, that is V naught is equal to KT, that is already given, it is 26 millivolt into ln, ND is equal to 10 to the power 17 per centimeter cube. And Na is equal to 10 to the power 16 per centimeter cube, which is given in the question. And Ni is equal to 1 for silicon, it is 1.5 into 10 to the power of minus 10. This is the concentration of the intrinsic concentration, which is given in the question, that is positive. And we have to take the square of this one. So after solving this one, we will get the voltage, that is the voltage which is called built-in voltage, which is the voltage due to accumulation of ions on two sides of the junction, that is positive and negative ions. And this is equal to 0.757 volt after solving this one. So why I'm finding this V naught value? Because after getting this V naught value, we can find out the total width of the depletion region. So the total width of the depletion region W is going to be find out by the equation, which is 2 into V naught, that is the built-in voltage which has find previously, into epsilon SI, the permittivity of silicon divided by Q, into 1 upon ND plus 1 upon NA. So by using this formula, we can find out the value of W. So if you know the value of W, then we can use this formula to find out, since we know that W is equal to WN plus WP. So if you know this value, then easily we can find out the value of WP. Or another formula that can be used to find out the WP value, if you are not knowing the value of WN, that is nothing but the total width into ND divided by NA plus ND. So this is the second formula that can be used. And since we don't know the value of WN, we can use this formula to get the width of the depletion region on P side, that is the penetration of depletion region on P side. So by using these two formula, we can find out the value of WP, and if you know the value of WP, then easily we can find out the charges per unit area on the depletion region of P side. So this will be the formula. So first of all, for getting this one, we can use the total width of the depletion region by using this equation. So this equation consists of W is equal to root over, that is 2, and V naught is equal to 0.757 volt. And from the given question, we have the formula for permittivity of silicon, that is equal to 2L into epsilon naught. Here epsilon naught is equal to 8.854 into 10 to the power of minus 2L, which can be used. And divided by Q is equal to 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 19. This thing we have found out just now, and all other things are given in the question. And then we have to take the formula extended, that is 10 to the power 16 per centimeter cube for donor atoms and 10 to the power 17 per centimeter cube for acceptor atoms. So if you solve this one, then we are getting the width of the depletion region is equal to 3.325 into 10 to the power of minus 6 centimeter. This is the total width of the depletion region. So as we can see, here we got the value of W. So now at last we have to put these values to find out the value of width of the depletion region on P side, that is WP, that is this width. The WP is nothing but the width of the depletion region on P side, that is this width. So we can use this formula, and width of the depletion region on P side is equal to W, that means 3.325 into 10 to the power of minus 6, and this is ND. ND, that means 10 to the power of 16 divided by 10 to the power of 17 plus 10 to the power of 16. So after solving this one, we are getting this is equal to 3.023 into 10 to the power of minus 7 centimeter. This is the value of the width of the depletion region on P side. So after finding out this width of the depletion region on P side, we can apply this particular formula to find out the value of the concentration of charges per unit area due to this width. So I am putting the value here. After putting, we can find out the value. So this is equal to 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 19 into Na, that is equal to 10 to the power of 17, and which is given in the question, and WP from there we can use it. This is equal to 3.023 into 10 to the power of minus 7 centimeter. That is from the given. And after solving all those things, finally we get the value. If you take in nanocoulomb, we have to find out the value in nanocoulomb per centimeter square. So this A will give the per centimeter square, and we have to find out the value in nanocoulomb. So the answer is 4.87 nanocoulomb per centimeter square. So this will be the answer of this question. So the final answer for this question is here. We can write this is equal to 4.87 nanocoulomb per centimeter square, and this will be the answer of this question.